Hello everyone, welcome to Bodhanappu Meena's channel. In this video, we are going to discuss and analyze the model question paper of Skill Pro 3, that is Communication and Soft Skills 3 paper in the fourth semester degree examinations, which are going to be held under SV University. So the question paper is for 50 marks and the duration is 2 hours. You'll be having 5 Romans in the question paper. And from each Roman, you'll be getting 5 questions, among which you have to attempt any 2. And each question will get a weightage of 5 marks. So 2 into 5, 10 marks. And 10 into 5 Romans, that is 50 marks you'll get. And if you learn any 3 topics in each unit, it will be more than enough to get 45 plus marks in the communication skills. So let us see one by one. The first Roman is from the first unit, that is the soft skills. So you can expect the questions from positive attitude, body language, SWOT analysis, emotional intelligence and etiquette. Let us see the questions which you got in the supplementary examination held in November 2020, this year. So what are the advantages of possessing positive attitude? What is the importance of body language in communication skills? How does the SWOT analysis help the students? Discuss the role of emotional intelligence in one's personality development. Why should one follow etiquette? And in the second Roman, it is from paragraph writing and expansion of ideas. So let us see the questions here. What are the elements of good paragraph? What do you think that paragraph writing requires creativity? Sorry, why do you think that paragraph writing requires creativity? What are the types of paragraphs? Write a paragraph on cyber crimes. Expand any one of the following ideas. Honesty is the best policy. Prevention is better than cure. Again, you are having a choice in expansion of ideas in the second Roman. So you can expand any one of the proverb here. Let us see the third Roman. Attempt any 2 of the following questions. What are the elements of paraphrasing? Discuss any 2 techniques of paraphrasing. What are the features of good summary? Paraphrase the following poem. And hark, how blithe the throstle sings. He too is no mean preacher. Come forth into the light of things. Let nature be your teacher. He has a boat of ready wealth, our minds and hearts to bless. Spontaneous wisdom breathed by health, truth breathed by cheerfulness. One impulse from a vernal wood may teach you more of a man, of moral evil and of good, than all the sages can. So here they have given a poem written by Wordsworth, and you have to paraphrase. That means you have here they have given the poem, which is having figures of speech and which are having difficult words which we can't understand by seeing it. Here you have to paraphrase this poem into the simple words. The next question is, discuss briefly the advantages and disadvantages of social media. From the fourth unit, that is letter writing, you'll get 5 questions. So the examples are here. Distinguish between a formal and informal letter. What are the parts of a business letter? Why is e-correspondence very popular? What is the layout of an email? You have purchased a mobile online. It has certain features missing. Write an email to the company asking for replacement. So here you have to write a letter to the mobile online store from where you have purchased, stating that there are some features which are missing and you have to ask for replacement. And the next 5th Roman is, attempt any 2 of the following questions, that is from resume or curriculum vitae and cover letter. Write about the importance of resume or CV in the job market. How is resume different from CV? Write a CV for the post of program analyst. Prepare a resume for your dream job. What is a cover letter? So these are the questions which were asked in the supplementary examination held in November 2020, that is this year. So for your seniors, and this is the model question paper. So let us see the answers for this model question paper one by one in detail. So what are the advantages of? This is not processing, it is possessing. So what are the advantages of possessing positive attitude? So what is the need of having a positive attitude? So positive thinking or positive attitude helps us to derive satisfaction from what we have and what we do. So it gives satisfaction. Positive thinking guides us to success and peace of mind. It gives success and peace of mind. So positive thinking can make reaching away our goals easier and more enjoyable. Next, positive thinking helps us to become a flexible person. Positive thinking helps us to unfold the world of problems. Positive thinking helps us to motivate ourselves. So what are the advantages here? Success, it gives success and peace, helps in reaching goals, helps to become flexible, motivates ourselves. It helps to solve the problems or unfolds the problems. It gives a satisfaction. So these are the advantages of positive attitude or positive thinking. Let us see the next question in the first Roman. What is the importance of body language in communication skills? So as you know, communication is of two types, verbal communication and non-verbal communication. Verbal communication we will do with our words or with our speech. So non-verbal communication we'll do with the help of facial expressions, postures, eye contact, and spatial distance. So body language is a part of non-verbal communication, which includes facial expressions, eye contact, posture, and spatial distance. It is more important than the verbal communication because it is learned first, and even before we utter a single word, we can make an expression on others through our body language. So at least 65% of our communication is conveyed through our body. And according to Peter F. Drucker, he stated that the most important thing in communication is hearing what isn't said. So what is the most important thing in communication? So hearing what is not set. It is given by Peter F. Drucker. Then let us see the next question. How does the SWOT analysis help the students? So SWOT analysis, SWOT means strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. But it has been changed into SWOC, C for challenge. So it helps why students are unable to reach their goals in life. It helps to understand various ways to reach their goals. It is beneficial to recognize both the opportunities available and the threats to face. By realizing weaknesses, one can overcome and escape threats. Its framework helps students to be unique from peers by showing their rare talents. It points out the need to boost their career and assist them to reach their personal goals. It steers you to excel in your profession. It discloses opportunities that you need to be utilized. It also helps to peep into them so that they can draft their career plan and complete it successfully. So SWOT analysis means you're analyzing yourself. You're just seeing your strengths. What are your strengths? Based on your strengths, you know where you can excel. And weak, W means weakness. So you'll know your weaknesses and you can find the ways to overcome your weaknesses and opportunities. You can find the way based on your study or qualification. You can find your ways in your career or paths, different paths in your career. And next is threats or challenges. So what are your challenges? So how you are going to overcome those challenges so you can make those things. The next is discuss the role of emotional intelligence in one's personality development. So here we have to explain how emotional intelligence is going to improve your personality development and what is the role in building a good personality. So emotional intelligence helps to change your perspective. So that means you will understand the facts of life, and instead of arguing with someone, you will adjust or mold yourself. Next is recognize and channelize emotions. So EI helps us to speak and feel free to express our emotions. So because of this emotional intelligence, you won't have to suppress your feelings, so which may lead to ill health or depression. So instead of that, you can express your feelings freely with your friends. Connect with people empathetically. It helps to connect with people empathetically and get rid of misunderstandings. So empathetic means, so feeling some other, feeling someone's situation to you and you'll assume it. So that is empathy. So we'll just think in some other situation and you will take the decision. Then let us see the next one. Next is enjoy and instill sense of humor. Emotional intelligence helps us to enjoy the work, what we do, and provide a positive environment and maintains a positive esteem on oneself. Resolve conflicts positively. Emotional intelligence helps us to use positive attitude and pours plenty of comfort and emotional satisfaction in life. Because of this positive attitude, we won't go for any arguments or conflicts or fights. And so that we can live a satisfaction life. Why should one follow netiquette? So netiquette is a set of rules that encourages appropriate and courteous online behavior. We should follow netiquette because they promote communication skills, prevent miscommunications, and help us to understand what is socially acceptable when working and collaborating online. Netiquette rules encourage social interactions, community building, and trust, and help to promote a safe, engaging, respectful, and collaborative environment. So by this, we have seen what are the questions that are asked from the first unit. And let us see the next Roman, that is from paragraph writing. What are the elements of good paragraph? So if you take the elements, they may ask regarding the elements of a good paragraph or the features of good paragraph. You have to write the same answer for both the questions. Elements of a good paragraph are unity, cohesion, coherence, balance, variety, and emphasis are the elements or features of a good paragraph. So unity means you have to combine the sentences, unite the sentences together with a central theme. The sentences of the paragraph are held together because of their close relation to the central theme. Their oneness of purpose gives unity to the paragraph. If sentences do not relate to the central idea, creep into the paragraph, its unity is destroyed, which results in confusion. And cohesion. Next is cohesion. The sentence and the paragraph are linked structurally by cohesive devices. So the sentences are united with the help of cohesive devices like conjunctions, pronouns, and the definite article. So these are called as cohesive devices in order to make the paragraph stable and clear. Next is coherence. So the sentences in the paragraph are united together with the meaning. So this relationship is called as coherence. The sentence of a good paragraph should be connected through semantics. That is, they should also be related in terms of meaning. This relationship is called as coherence. The next one is balance. The balance of paragraph depends on the proper distribution of emphasis. So from the starting of the paragraph till the end, the central idea or the logical development should be maintained. So that is called as balance. Next is variety. A good paragraph should avoid monotony. Monotony means the same length, same structure, sentence structure, or using of same words or same idea same words should be avoided. So in order to avoid that monotony, it should have different lengths and not always the same sentence construction. It should be a combination of simple, compound, and complex sentences. Next, emphasis. Emphasis is nothing but conclusion. Paragraph should come to a close where the treatment of the particular subject is exhausted. So at the end, you have to conclude the paragraph. So what are the elements of a good paragraph? First one is unity, coherence, cohesion, balance, variety, and emphasis. Let us see the next question. Why do you think that paragraph writing requires creativity? For writing a paragraph, the writer should decide a controlling idea and create a topic sentence. So the topic sentence should be supported by the facts, figures, and experiences which the writer should correlate with the topic sentence. The writer might illustrate the topic sentence with examples. Later, he should emphasize the topic sentence, and the entire paragraph should stand on a particular central idea, and each sentence should be meaningful, and there should be flow of idea throughout the passage. So for all these things, paragraph writing needs creativity. So why it needs creativity means for selection of topic sentence and for for supporting that, we need the facts, figures, and experiences. We have to correlate with that, and we have to illustrate with the help of examples, and we have to emphasize the topic sentence. An entire paragraph should stand on a particular central idea, and each sentence should be meaningful. For all these things, the writer or the paragraph writing needs creativity. Then what are the types of paragraph? Based on the nature of the subject discussed in the paragraph and the style of writing, paragraphs are divided into three types. That is, first one is descriptive paragraphs, exploratory paragraphs, and narrative paragraphs. The descriptive paragraph which contains a series of sentences with descriptive details, which together make a picture of what the writer is trying to describe, is called a descriptive paragraph. A descriptive paragraph are common in story writing. So writers usually employ adjectives and descriptive language to write descriptive paragraphs. So here the descriptive paragraph, it is used in story writings, and we will use the descriptive words like adjectives and descriptive language to describe such kind of paragraphs to make a picture of what the writer is about to say something or about to describe something. So such kind of paragraphs are called as descriptive paragraph. The exploratory paragraph. So here we can create a paragraph giving the details of information in support of the topic sentence. When we are giving facts or figures, so in order to support the topic sentence, then such kind of paragraph becomes the exploratory paragraph. So we can create a paragraph giving the details of information in support of the topic sentence. This used when we explain something with the help of facts and figures. The details of exploratory paragraph should be arranged so as to make the reader follow the explanation clearly from beginning to end. The next one is the narrative paragraph. The narrative paragraph is written to relate an experience or to narrate an incident. So if something had happened before, if you wanted to narrate that incident, so we will use this narrative paragraph. The sentences in the narrative paragraph should be clearly arranged in a logical sequence so as to guide the reader to understand the incident properly. It is not always possible to have topic sentences for the narrative paragraph because it depends on the writer's experience or an incident. Let us see the next question. Write a paragraph on cyber crimes. So cybercrime, what do you mean by a cybercrime? Which involves the computers or the digital devices in which a computer can either be a target of the crime or a tool of the crime or contain evidence of the crime. So cybercrime basically defined as any criminal activity that occurs over the internet. There are many examples such as fraud, malware such as viruses, identity threat, and cyber stalking. In present environment, since most information processing depends on the use of information technology, the control, prevention, and investigation of cyber activities is vital to the success of the organizations, government agencies, and individuals. The procurement and maintenance of highly skilled cybercrime expert by government and business enterprises cannot be exaggerated. The next question is, expand any one of the following ideas. Honesty is the best policy. So let us see how to expand this proverb. Every religion tells us that we must be honest. No one likes dishonest people because they cannot be trusted. The truth is always so simple. Dishonesty is like a web that has no beginning and no end. Sometimes we are punished for being honest, but it is nothing compared to the pain and suffering we cause due to dishonesty. Gandhi laid great emphasis on the need to be truthful in words and deeds. His life throughout was a struggle to uphold the virtue of truth. A truthful man can speak and act with moral conviction. He commands respect and reverence in society. Being honest at all times is the best policy to follow in life. Speaking the truth may at times put you through hardships, but ultimately only good things will result from it. To stand up to the truth requires a great deal of courage, and an honest person is always treated with respect and love by everyone. Let us see, the prevention is better than cure. The meaning of the proverb, prevention is better than cure. It is easy to prevent a problem from happening than to solve the problem after it has already happened. This proverb is similar to a proverb, a stitch in time saves nine. The cost of preventive maintenance is much lower than the cost of repairing the damaged ones. This proverb asks us to develop proper planning and foresight, to take careful steps and avoid damages to health, business, personal relationships, safety measures, etc. We should be careful enough to take all appropriate preventive measures for known risks and personal lives, workplaces, industries, government, international issues, and environmental issues or global issues too. Benjamin Franklin rightly said that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Rather than regret after every heavy damage to health, business relationships, and global issues, it is wise to prevent disasters and lead peaceful lives. Let us see the third Roman, that is from paraphrasing and summarizing. What are the elements of paraphrasing or features of paraphrasing? The paraphrase of a poem or a passage contains the same ideas or theme. In other words, it does not contain any new ideas or opinions. No idea or sub-theme is repeated. So without changing the meaning, we are using simple words. Then all the figures of speech are expressed in simple and direct language, and it should not contain similes, metaphors, epigrams, and such other figures of speech. The sentences are not long and complex, as the paraphrase aims to make the text or poem comprehensible to the reader. There are no sentences in direct speech, no sentences containing inversion, and no rhetorical questions. Technical, archaic, unusual, understood words are not found unless they are absolutely necessary. Let us see the next question. Discuss any two techniques of paraphrasing. Techniques of paraphrasing involve, it might be the stages in paraphrasing, or it might be guidelines of paraphrasing and strategies for paraphrasing. So these are the three techniques for paraphrasing, and here I have discussed only the first two techniques here. So paraphrasing involves three stages, namely pre-paraphrasing stage, writing stage, and editing stage. And the pre-paraphrasing stage involves reading a text or poem and understanding the central idea or theme and noting down the main idea and supporting ideas, if any. Next is writing stage. So comprising of expressing their ideas in simple and vocabulary sentences. So whatever you note down the supporting ideas, now you will elaborate into sentences. Next is editing stage. Finally, the write-up is looked at for any ungrammatical sentences and proofreading errors and corrected. So here, if you have any grammatical errors, you will correct them in this editing stage. Next technique is guidelines for paraphrasing. Read the poem or passage slowly and carefully. Understand its central idea. When you have lost the main idea or theme, read the poem or passage again to understand all other details. Note all unusual words and expressions, as well as similes, metaphors, epigrams, and other figures of speech, which will have to be explained in simple, direct language. Direct speech should be converted to indirect speech. The full meaning of phrases and expressions should be bought, and that have to be rearranged in order to make the meaning clear. If you are writing a paraphrase in indirect speech and you begin with the words the poet says, do not repeat the words or their variants like the poet further adds or the poet further says. As far as length is concerned, there are no limits stated. Normally, the prose passage is longer than the poetic that has been for a paraphrased. The regularity of rhythm of poetry should be modified into the regular rhythm of prose. The operation should be by prose constructions. Useful verbs connecting words and explanations which have been omitted in the poem should be applied or supplied. Provide reference of citations wherever necessary. So you have to quote wherever necessary. So what are the features of good summary? Summary is nothing but putting together the main ideas in the note making in a sequential written form. The features of good summary are: it should be simple, clear, and well structured. It contains main theme and supporting ideas. Good summary is written in your own words. It contains very few words. Summary is always shorter than the original. Next, paraphrase the following poem written by Wordsworth. So, and hark how bleak the throstle sings, he too is no mean preacher, come forth into the light of things, let nature be your teacher. He has a boat of ready wealth, our minds and hearts to bless, spontaneous wisdom breathed by health, truth breathed by cheerfulness, one impulse from a vernal wood may teach you more of a man, of moral evil and of good, than all the sages can. He asked his friend to listen to all the things around him in nature and observe, as they are much nicer and sweeter than the preachy lessons that the authors of the books sound like. He finds the books very preachy and boring, and he urges that his friend comes in the light of things that really exist around him. He pleads to his friend that for once he should let nature be his teacher. The poet says that the nature around us is full of knowledge and teachings. Nature is the best thing to bless anyone's heart. Nature could fill one's heart with a heart and health with wisdom. Nature could fill someone's heart and soul with cheerfulness and joy. Nature will fill anyone's heart with joy and cheerfulness. The poet says that one element of nature could teach his friend more than what the books could teach him. The books cannot contain the knowledge that the nature could provide. Nature could provide him. The trees and the woods could teach him much more about truth and morals, much more than the sages put together could teach him. So here the paraphrase is regarding the nature. Instead of reading the book, the teacher, nature will teach you more when compared to the authors of the books. So that is the overall concept or overall idea of the poem. Next is expand briefly the advantages and disadvantages of social media. A social media is an online platform that helps to build relationships, both social and professional. It includes internet websites, blogs, forums, dashboards, wikis, etc. Examples of Google, Facebook, Twitter, Skype, and LinkedIn, etc. Advantages of social media. Social media is helpful to people in improving social skills, independence of self-expression, digital computer, and education development. It also opens up many avenues on one's career and growth. Disadvantages of social media are include sharing of personal information, loss of privacy, isolation, overexpression, development of digital relationships, loss of original thinking, leading to overexpression and individuality and addiction to social media. So these are the disadvantages of social media. And let us move to the next question. Distinguish between a formal and informal letter. So formal letters and informal letters. Formal letters are written to organizations, government departments, shareholders, etc. And informal letters are written to friends and relatives and family members. The purpose of formal letters is to make complaints, requests, inquiries, orders, etc. And informal letters is for casual. And the tone that is used in formal letters is full of respect, making use of formal words and sentences to create a nice impression on the recipient. So here the tone in the informal letters is no need to create an impression. You can write as if you are talking to a person in front of you. Formal letter follow a set format, but there is no set format for the informal letters, and there is no need to be using formal style and tone. So let us see what are the parts of a business letter. Parts of a business letter contain heading or writer's address, receiver's address, the salutation and the subscription, the body, and the signature. So heading or the writer's address. Many business houses or administrative offices have their own letterheads. The heading which is on the top of the page is called as heading. Next is receiver's address. In formal letter, it is needed to address the receiver's name, to whom we are addressing, like to the CEO or the bank manager, or managing director, HR, etc. The salutation and the subscription. In formal letters, we use salutations like dear sir, dear madam, sir, Mr. Rao, and subscriptions like yours faithfully, yours truly, sincerely, etc. The body. An official letter should be up to the point. The message should be conveyed in clear and courteous style. Signature. The writer has to put his full signature. The name of the writer is also written clearly or typed below the signature. So these are the parts of a business letter. What are the parts? Heading or writer's address, receiver's address, salutation and subscription, body, and signature. Then let us see the next question. Why is e-correspondence very popular? E-correspondence refers to the corresponding someone using email. Most of the correspondence is made on email, as email is fast. Can reach any corner of the world any time of the day. It is cost effective. You can send the message right from your desk, from your own comfort, provided with internet. So these are the importance of e-correspondence, or this is how, or this is why it became popular. So what is the layout of an email? So I have given the layout. 2 is the sender's address. CC is the carbon copy, and BCC is the blind carbon copy, and we have to write the subject for which you are going to write the mail. And this is the attachment. B is bold, italic, the font, and the color. And if you wanted to save, you can save. You can save as a draft, and you can send. The next question is, you have purchased a mobile online. It has certain features missing. Write an email to the company asking for the replacement. So I have written the true address here to XYZ company. And what is the subject? Mobile replacement. So dear Mr. X, I have ordered Vivo Mobile from your online store with the online reference number so and so. By the time of receiving my product, I felt there are some features missing. So I need mobile with the selected features which I opted earlier. Kindly replace this mobile at the earliest possible. Waiting for your response. With regards, your name. So this is how you had to write the email. And let us see the next Roman from resume and cover letter. Write about the importance of resume or CV in the job market. So what is the importance of resume? Resume is an important tool for your job search because it offers a page or two where you can display your top skills and qualities. In order to display your skills and qualities, it is needed. Resumes help employers make hiring decisions in order to decide the employees. The employers will use the resumes. Resumes open the gate for the interview. And employers use resumes to get a deeper understanding of the candidate's skills, strengths, and experience. Let us see the next question. How is resume different from CV? Resume is different from CV So the differences between the resume and CV is, the word resume is borrowed from the French and Latin, and curriculum vitae is a Latin word. The resume meaning is synopsis or summary. Meaning of CV is course of life. Resume is shorter than CV. CV can be slightly longer than resume. Resume is usually a page length. CV may run into two pages. So these are the differences between resume and curriculum vitae. So write a CV for the post of program analyst. So I have given, actually the CV is, this kind of CV is for your examination purpose. So it should contain the heading. Heading should be your name and address, objective. So what is your career objective? And what is, if you're having any professional previous experience, write the professional experience, or else directly you can go to the educational qualification. And additional information like personal traits, you can write, or what are your extra qualities, you can mention there. And references, you have to mention. So what are the parts of the CV? Heading, objective, professional experience, educational qualification, additional information, and references. That too you have to mention, that is available on request or if they need. So let us see the next question. Prepare a resume for your dream job. So, prepare a resume for your dream job. I have given a sample here for the soft skill trainer, and you have to write that. So, what is your dream job? You can mention according to you. Then what is a cover letter? A cover letter is a letter which accompanies a CV or resume. The cover letter informs our prospective employer that we are aware of their needs and requirements, and we have the required skills and knowledge. Moreover, it allows them to know what we are interested in working with them. So these are all the questions that are asked in the November supplementary examination for fourth semester. So I hope you have understood and analyzed the model question paper and came to know how to write and how to answer the questions given. So all the best for your examination. Thank you.